Penguin Random House Audio presents Dragons of Deceit, Dragonlance Destinies, Volume 1, by Margaret Weis and Tracy Hickman. Read for you by Kirsten Potter. The Call of the River, by Michael Williams. Because a name is destiny, the soul impelled by imperative of language, by the blind direction of heart, and because the riverbank where we stand, half witness, half part of the current, is and is not the tidal surge, there is this vacancy we fill with imagining, the impulse of ancestry, of place and of nurture. This gap between dream and what we will never be, bridged by the God's finger, the shape of star and season, until we can say, look there, out in midstream, where the dark breaks and crests the surface of water, where something we make is making us, and where the birds of the river tilt wings and splinter the water, and for a moment the current almost means what we are supposed to be. Prologue. Castle Rosethorn was located on a tor overlooking the fertile valley through which ran the Vingard River. The castle was ancient, dating back to pre-cataclysm times, modeled after other Salamnic fortresses of the era, although on a more modest scale. But Castle Rosethorn was far different from any other fortress due to the uniqueness of its location and its imaginative design. The castle was considered to possess an almost magical beauty. Little is known about the architect, for his name was lost to time. Perhaps he had grown weary of drawing up plans for utilitarian fortresses, or perhaps the name Rosethorn and the distinctive location on the tor had fired his imagination. He designed the six sides of its outer defensive curtain wall around the natural jutting stone formations of the tor, putting the contours to both aesthetic and practical use. Each of the six points of the battlements featured bastions that jutted out from the curtain wall, which were dubbed the Thorns. The keep that blossomed from the thorny walls was the Rose. Workmen had spent years delving the moat surrounding the castle out of the solid rock of the tor. The castle could be accessed only by a causeway and drawbridge, and prevented sappers from attempting to enter by digging beneath. Those seeking admittance had to pass through two gates to reach the castle and travel along a narrow cobblestone road. The lower gate was guarded by an iron portcullis that permitted entry to the narrow cobblestone road that ran between the cliff face on the right and the interior wall of the curtain wall on the left. Known as the Thorn Gauntlet, the road climbed as it curved between rock on one side and defensive parapets on the other. A swiftly flowing stream ran down a deep channel cut in the center of the cobblestones. The upper gate that guarded the Rose was located near the top of the curving thorn gauntlet. The gate was flanked by the waterfall that fed the stream. Once through the gate, the narrow cobblestone road opened onto an expansive bailey that surrounded the keep. The keep itself consisted of the main building and two round towers, the watchtower and the Rose Tower. The watchtower was short and wide and had no windows. A spiral staircase that wound around the exterior wall led upward to a bud-shaped cap. The Rose Tower was narrower and tapered toward the top. An interior spiral staircase climbed to a narrow balcony that surrounded the base of its ornate spire, which was crafted to look like a newly blooming rose. Lord Gregory Rosethorn had climbed the stair of the Rose Tower at dawn, as was often his habit. He liked to look out on the river far below, sparkling in the sunshine and shining on the fields of golden wheat, barley, beans, and oats, as well as lush pasture land. Sheep dotted the grassy hills. Cattle grazed. The smoke of cookfires rose from the village of Ironwood off in the distance. The river meandered among the low hills and shallow valleys and disappeared in the thick forests where the leaves were starting to change with the coming of autumn. The orange leaves of the maples flaunted their beauty among the dark blue-green of the firs and the rich green of the oak. The harvest would soon start. It would be a good one this year. Gregory leaned on the railing to gaze out over the fields, which were flooded yearly by the Vingard River during the winter ice melt, providing fertile soil for the crops. He looked north toward the Habakkuk Mountains and the famed Westgate Pass, the only pass through the mountains to the city of Palanthus. The pass was protected by a fortress known as the High Clarist's Tower. The fortress had been constructed by the founder of Salamnia and the knighthood, Vinus Salamnus, and had guarded the pass for centuries. It had been abandoned more than 300 years ago following the cataclysm, the departure of the gods, and the death of the last High Clarist. No one had been interested in taking the cleric's place, as the Salamniks had no intention of worshipping gods who had abandoned them during their hour of desperate need. Gregory looked east toward the Dargard mountain range. On clear days like today, he could see the peaks from the castle, already capped by snow. He was arrested by the sight of a fierce storm brewing in the east. Dark, turbulent clouds boiled in the skies above the mountains. Lightning flickered among them, illuminating the clouds with dread purple beauty. The morning sun rose over the peaks and streamed down on the land of Salamnia, defying the threatened darkness. Storms from the east did not often sweep down from the mountains into Salamnia, but now the clouds grew darker. Their enormous, black, lightning-streaked towers rose high into the heavens. Gregory felt the chill east wind ruffle his hair. He smelled rain, and he could now hear the distant rumble of thunder. Gregory shivered, and not just from the wind. He was overcome with a sense of foreboding. He shook his head, deriding himself. He was a knight of Salamnia, not a child to be frightened of crackling lightning and roaring thunder. Yet he could not banish the feeling. He watched the approaching storm and saw in his mind dark armies rolling unchallenged over the land. He could not pray to the gods to save his country, as knights had prayed to the gods in days long gone by, for now there were no gods to answer. Yet he waited for a sign that would give him hope. He waited for the sun to grow brighter and stronger and banish the darkness. The clouds massed and then thundered down the peaks of the mountains and devoured the sun. The dawn died, banished by what seemed a new night. Gregory defied the storm and remained on the ramparts, nurturing his hope until a bolt of lightning struck so close he could hear it sizzle and smell the brimstone. The thunder shook the castle walls, and the rain pelted down on his head, thoroughly soaking him. At last, driven from the ramparts, he walked slowly down the tower stairs, trying to shake the feeling of dread from his heart as he shook the water from his long hair, for today was his beloved daughter's day of life gift. Gregory was determined to think only of her. "The dark clouds will pass," he said to himself. "Storms that strike this early in the morning rarely last past noon. The sun will shine on her special day." But when he stopped at a tower window and looked to the east, all he saw was darkness. Book 1. Chapter 1. Destina Rosethorn was a child of destiny. She was born in the year 337 AC, and she came by her name when her mother, Atieno, read the omens and told her father, Knight of the Crown Gregory Rosethorn, that his child would shape the destiny of nations. Gregory was loyal to the measure, as were all true Salamnic knights, and he did not believe in omens, for they implied that man had no control over his own fate. Given that his son would be the scion of a wealthy and influential knight of the crown, Gregory did not need an omen to foretell the future. He chose the name Destin, which means destiny, and gave Atieno a pair of golden earrings in the shape of crowns to mark the occasion. Gregory was therefore understandably surprised when the child who was to shape the destiny of nations turned out to be a girl. Atieno had known from the omens that she would bear a daughter, but she had withheld that knowledge from her husband. Among her people, female children were trained as warriors to fight alongside the men, for their tribe was small, and if it was attacked, everyone must come to its defense. But her husband was Salamnic, and while women were trained to fight in the defense of the home, they could not become knights or inherit property without a special dispensation. Etienne loved her husband with all her heart. She would have done anything to please him, except the one thing over which she had no control. She had not been able to give him a son, to carry on the family name and traditions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.